Welcome. Turn to the problems in your absorption versus variable costing lecture notes and we'll take a closer look. The following information relates to the second month of operations for Medical Research Corp. The company had beginning inventory of 2,000 units, produced its normal capacity of 12,000 units, and sold 13,000 units. Assume the cost structure did not change over the two-month period. Sales $130,000, production cost incurred, variable $48,000, fixed $12,000. Selling and administrative expenses incurred, variable $18,000, fixed $6,000. Based on this, we're supposed to calculate net operating income and value ending finished goods inventory using both absorption costing and variable costing. We'll begin with absorption costing. In order to prepare an income statement or value inventory, we are going to need to compute the production cost per unit. Recall that under absorption costing, we'll include all production costs, both variable and fixed. The variable production costs were given to be $48,000. This does include, by definition, direct materials used, direct labor, and variable overhead. This $48,000 of cost was incurred to produce 12,000 units. So the variable production cost per unit is $4. Fixed production costs were given to be $12,000. This was incurred to produce 12,000 units. So the fixed production cost per unit is $1. The total production cost per unit then will include both the variable and fixed components, and it's $5 per unit. Now we can prepare the income statement. Absorption costing does use the traditional format, so we'll begin with sales, which were given to be $130,000. Then we'll subtract cost of goods sold. We sold 13,000 units, so cost of goods sold will be $5 times 13,000 units, or $65,000. Gross margin then is $65,000, and from this we'll subtract our operating expenses. This is where we'll subtract the selling and administrative expenses incurred during the period. We were told that the variable selling expenses were $18,000 and the fixed selling and administrative expenses were $6,000. This is the amount incurred during the period, and period costs are expensed in full. So we will expense all of the costs incurred. This leaves us with net operating income of $41,000. Now we're going to value the ending finished goods inventory, and so we'll need to remember that the production cost per unit is $5. We previously calculated that. We also will need to figure out how many units are we trying to value. So I've shown here what was given in the paragraph. The company had beginning inventory of 2,000 units. They produced normal capacity of 12,000 units, and they sold 13,000 units. So we can figure out how many units are remaining by taking beginning units plus production minus units sold equal ending units, or 2,000 plus 12,000 more produced minus 13,000 that were sold. And we see that we're trying to value 1,000 units. And since they're each going to be valued at the production cost per unit of $5, the value of the ending finished goods inventory will be 1,000 units times $5 per unit, or $5,000. Now we'll take a look at doing this for variable costing. We'll calculate both income and value the ending finished goods inventory. We will need to first compute the variable production cost per unit. We want to include all variable production costs, that is direct materials, direct labor, and variable overhead. We know that $48,000 of variable production cost was incurred during the period. We also know that that was incurred to produce 12,000 units. So our variable production cost per unit is $4. Now we can prepare our income statement. The variable costing income statement will use the contribution margin format, so we will begin with sales, which were given to be $130,000. We will then subtract variable costs. We will typically have both production cost and selling and administrative costs. The production cost will be through the variable cost of goods sold. We found our cost per unit to be $4 for materials, labor, and variable overhead. We sold 13,000 units. So our cost of goods sold will be $52,000. As for the variable selling expenses, we incurred $18,000 given in the problem, and we'll expense $18,000. Period costs are expensed in the period incurred. This leaves us a contribution margin of $60,000. Next, we'll subtract our fixed costs. You will typically have fixed production costs and fixed selling and administrative costs. Fixed overhead, $12,000. And under variable costing, we expense all of that. In fact, we do not treat this as if it's a product cost at all. We expense it in the period incurred. Fixed selling and administrative expenses, the amount incurred was $6,000, and we always expense these in the period incurred. This leaves us net operating income of $42,000. We're going to value the ending finished goods now, so you'll need to remember that there are 1,000 units remaining. We had 2,000 to begin with. We made 12,000 more, but we sold 13,000. So we previously calculated that 1,000 units were remaining. We also previously calculated that the cost per unit is $4. So the value of our ending finished goods inventory under variable costing will be 1,000 units times $4 per unit, or $4,000. Now this concludes the problem on absorption versus variable costing. You will note that income was different by $1,000 and the value of ending finished goods inventory was different by $1,000. You should be able to explain why this difference occurred through a look at the fixed overhead account. If you have questions on that, be sure to bring them to class. See you then.